Welcome to Pretty Pictures, Classic Records, Marvel, and Corpses, episode 259 of the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast.
In this episode, Marc Specter of Grand Gamers Guild joins us to talk about what we've been playing lately, which includes, for us, Marvel Champions, Endeavor Deep Sea, Cadaver, Pitcher Perfect, and Vinyl Jukebox. After that, we've got a detailed review of Giant Vinyl Jukebox, a very thematic two-player-only game.
Before that, some introductions. I'm Sean, your host, and here with me, we have our editor and webmaster, Deanna.
Hey to all my fellow cardboard connoisseurs.
And the Tabletop Bellhop himself, Mo T.
I am Mo Tuzano, the Tabletop Bellhop, your cardboard concierge, helping you make your game nights better.
We record this podcast live Wednesday nights at 8 p.m. Eastern at twitch.tv/tabletopbellhop, and we love it when people join us in the lobby, our chat room. This episode exists thanks to our Patreon patrons and our sponsor, Grand Gamers Guild.
You can find detailed show notes for this episode at tabletopbellhop.com/episode259. That's 259. Links in our show notes may be affiliate links, which cost you nothing but support us.
Now it's time for the Bellhop's Tabletop, where we talk about the games that we've been playing lately.
Well, we've got a special guest with us tonight, Marc Specter, the owner of Grand Gamers Guild, who joined us to be part of our first ever publisher AMA. So let's start with you, Marc. What have you been playing lately?
Sure. So I am very fortunate in that I have cultivated a game group of two or three people who meet on Tuesdays during the day. Sometimes we play prototypes. Sometimes we play published games, old and new, to stay abreast of the market and also to see what's come before. The first game that we played, we're recording this on a Wednesday, obviously. So yep. Yesterday was game day. And the first game we played was Snowdonia. It's a couple years old. My friend, whose house we were at, is a really big fan. And we've been meeting at my house pretty much the entire year. And Snowdonia is a big box. I think he got it off of a Kickstarter where it had all the things in it. And I'd played it once many years ago. And I said, hey, why don't we do that again? And why don't we do it at your house? You don't have to bring this box over. Mm-hmm. And we went over. He had it set up. And we played the first scenario. And it is, it was great. I mean, it's a worker placement game where the economy is super tight. You have two workers. You might have a third worker. You are gathering resources, converting resources, laying track, building stations. And it is a game that will benefit from repeat plays, as right. was evidenced by my friend who completely slaughtered me with a score of almost double what I did. Oh, geez. If you have the opportunity to play it, I highly recommend it. It is just a very nuanced worker placement game that definitely deserves exploration beyond, just a one play and, oh, right. I don't get that. I should move on to something else.
Yeah, that's one of my lookout games, one of the big heavier games. Now, I do know there is an updated version, which is Alubari, A Nice Cup of Tea. Have you played the updated version?
No, I wasn't aware that okay. It had been sort of re-implemented.
Yeah, re-implemented in 2019. So it's the original is like a 2012 game. 2019, they released Alubari, A Nice Cup of Tea. And I got to say, there was some hype on the podcast networks about that one. I've heard some good okay. things about Alubari.
Well, that's interesting because the Snowdonia Deluxe Master Set came out in 2019 as well, which is the full kit of like all the bits. It's the list of expansions that comes with the master kit is kind of terrifying to look at.
Right. Is that what you're talking about? That's what he has. Okay. So the question now becomes if we're going to, as a group, pursue that through its all the iterations. We'll okay. see what happens. I'm down for it, but you only got so much time.
They actually describe it as blah, 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 all that list, and everything else, everything Tony ever published, designed for campaigns, scribbled on envelopes, etc.
That's awesome. Now, for us, it was a great week of gaming. At this point, we've now played as many game sessions, like sit down, actual play a game from start to end in October as all of September, which is awesome because September felt a little dry. First one I'm going to talk about is we're sticking with older stuff here. Marvel Champions, the card game, the living card game from Fantasy Flight Games. That's a cooperative deck construction game, right? You're building your deck before you play, though we haven't really dived into that much. This we ended up playing on date night. Deanna and I took a night off last week where we spent out in Kingsville, and I decided to grab this one just for something different to play. And I wanted something that wasn't obligation, something we weren't rushing to get reviewed or anything like that, which was also a nice break. Now, this is a game where you're going to pick your Marvel hero, and then you're going to pick an aspect, and the aspects are like leader and justice and aggression. You're going to choose which villain to go up against, and then, again, you get to mash decks here. You pick a side plot that the villain, it could happen while you were battling the villain. Plays 1 to 4 players. All I have is the core box, right? The Marvel Champions, the card game core set from Fantasy Flight. And until this past week, we had played it once, I don't know, 4 or 5 years ago. And it was a botched demo game at a brewery that closed before we were able to finish. And we just never went back to it. Well, that's changed because we broke this out on the weekend, played it in our hotel room, and then played it 4 more times this past week. So as you can tell, we got a little hooked with this one. Started with just the starter set, right? The Spider-Man deck and the Captain Marvel deck that are preset in the box against Rhino, and then moved on to try other combinations. And like at this point, I played Black Panther with the protection deck, Captain Marvel with the aggression deck, and Spider-Man with the justice deck. And we tried fighting off both Rhino and Claw with, I don't remember what they're called, but the recommended side plots.
Yeah, I also tried Spider-Man with Justice, and then I moved on to She-Hulk with Aggression, and I stayed there because one of the things I'm finding fascinating about this game is how you play the deck a couple times, and you can really see what you need to do to master that particular combination or what you would want to do to tweak the deck, because you can. It's a living card game. You can, you know, take a couple things out, put a couple things in. Like with She-Hulk, I found that I really had to be constantly swapping between Jennifer Walters and She-Hulk to take advantage of what she had going on. Even from the first time we played it, which was an aborted, somewhat subpar experience, really this game intrigued me, and the art and everything about it, just it captures the comic book vibe. The side plots, the villains, everything. I dig it. I dig the way that you have things that you put in that are based on which heroes you're playing, that the obstructions, is it called, that you put in based on your hero. There's, I don't know, I found it amusing. you know, it's still novel at this point because we haven't played it a ton.
Yeah, it's a neat game because you start off as your alter ego and you play cards, which you pay for from other cards in your hand. So it's one of those games where your resources are your cards. There's a multi-use there. Each turn, though, you can swap between being your alter ego and switching to the hero. So you can be Peter Parker. You start as Peter Parker, but at any point during your turn, you can swap back. Now, you can only do that once per turn, so you're stuck for the rest of the turn. And when you're a hero, you can beat up the baddie and their minions, and you can thwart their plans or just sit back and defend. But as your alter ego, you can't do any of that. All you can do is rest and recuperate and put new cards into play. And then the neat part is after all the players have gone, the villain activates, and it's once per player, once per hero. And what they do depends if you're out there or not, right? So if you're your alter ego, if you're Peter Parker, the villain just schemes. They progress their plots, which is how they win the game. Whereas if you're Spider-Man, you're out there, they, of course, battle you and send minions after you. And I thought it was really neat. And then at the end of the turn, you each draw a card from the villain deck, and then bad things happen, like new schemes being launched and minions being put into play. And what Deanna was talking about there is your nemesis can show up, and your nemesis has their own plot that's happening. And the cool part to that is it's 100% slide plot. Like, your goal is to stop Rhino from breaking into the shield facility, but meanwhile, here comes Vulture doing his own damn thing, and you got to deal with both, which I got to say, there's not much more Spider-Man than that. I just love the way the interplay between the hero and the alter ego plays out, and the way the villain's focus changes. Like, sometimes you're like, we need to sit back and rest. But by sitting back and resting, the villain's getting their plots done, and that's how they win. And then other times you're like, no, we need to be out there as a hero so that they're not scheming and they're busy fighting us so they don't get anything done. It's just really fascinating the way it plays.
And it's not too easy for a cooperative game. I actually rather enjoy it, and I'm not big on, I know, again, I'm saying here's a cooperative game that I like, but it's not too easy. We really have to pay attention. We got absolutely creamed the one round when we the first time we played the harder level scenario. What I was not talking about the nemesis, but the, is it called obligation, obstruction, something? Peter Parker's rent is due. Yeah, Peter Parker's rent's due. Jennifer Walters has to actually go be a lawyer. Those things being thrown into the villain deck, I was amused by.
That's your obligation cards.
Yeah.
You played that one at all, Mark?
I am not. I am, I like superheroes as much as the next guy, but not if the next guy, Sean. but I tend not to gravitate towards a lot of IP-based games. I call it my I don't know, independent nature of things.
Fair.
So, Mark, anything else you've been playing lately? It sounds like you really only get that one big game a week. But, you know, we don't talk to you that often. So what else has been at the table lately?
Sure. No, we did get, in addition to Snowdonia yesterday, two other smaller gaming experiences.
Okay. Cool.
One is a brand new game that's not even out yet. It's by Mighty Acorn Games, which is spearheaded by Daniel Rocky, who you may know is co-designer of the Artemis Project. And it's called Smores Galore. It is a s'more building game where you are going to draft a row of ingredient cards, graham crackers, chocolate, and marshmallows. You are going to lay them out in a tableau in front of you in the exact order that you collected them. And then you are going to churn, burn, or return cards in order to get your chocolate, graham cracker, and marshmallow in the proper order to make different types of s'mores. So you have, for instance, your standard s'more, which is a graham cracker on either end and chocolate or marshmallow in either order. And you score a regular s'more card. But then there are others like Graham Slam, which is just three graham crackers in a row, or Hot Mess, which is chocolate, marshmallow chocolate, and a whole bunch of others. So it's accessible. It is super cute, plays in about half an hour, and yet it is still thinky enough to be engaging. So we're talking about a game that is probably accessible age 10 and up, but is still going to present logical challenges to adults who are longtime gamers. Tons of fun, gorgeously illustrated with these cute, not animated, but like... anthropomorphic, that's the word. Okay. Anthropomorphic s'more components. And we'll actually have that for the very first time at PAX Unplugged. We had two cases shipped over here direct from China so that we'd have it in time and that people would be able to have a nice, cozy family game for their holiday season. Only about 48 copies, I think. So definitely in short supply. So I'm certain, like every other game I've had at a convention this year, they're just going to fly out as soon as they make their appearance.
All right. Don't curse yourself there.
And the artist for that is Christiane Foch from Catapult Feud fame. Doing the art on that one.
Time Roller suggests that as a publisher, just looking at an IP causes you to go a little bit into debt. That's probably why you don't want to look at IP games.
That is true. And I will tell you this. Early on in the Artemis Project, we actually had looked at, there is a series. Oh my gosh, the author's name is escaping me. It'll probably come as soon as we're done. But a book series called Coyote. And I had loosely thought about IPing Artemis up with the Coyote series of books. They are amazing books. And it is a sad, sad thing that I can't remember the name of the author.
Is that Alan anyway. Steele?
Yes, there you go. Thank you. I actually had literally talked to Alan. He referred me to his agent. And then, you know, like these things do, they kind of fell apart because, you know, contracts and, you know, obligations that are already in place and so on and so forth.
All right. Up next for us, also first played on our night off was Vinyl Jukebox. This is a very thematic game about collecting 45s, vinyl records for the younger gamers out there, placing them into your jukebox. It's a two-player only game. It's a bag builder where the bag is your coin purse. On your turn, you pull coins out of your bag and put them on the machine, hoping to make a set that claims the records you want. Now, the sets are music style, A-side or B-side, and a decade. Now, there's three decades, 40s, 60s. 40s, 60s, five music styles, jazz, blues, etc. Every time you complete a row or column of records, you get to claim a scoring tile based on the best set you made. So like one, it might be I have three blues records in a row, so that scores me more points. Or I have three blues records in a row, but I also have three A-sides, and A-sides are worth more. So you're trying to decide which point cards to go for. You also get points for collected records matching your hidden goal. So your own musical taste. You get like three musical taste cards at the beginning, discard one, keep two, and you are going to sit there and try to collect records. Now, we are reviewing this one later tonight, so I don't want to get into any more detail about it, just to say that it's a cool looking game, a cool theme that does a good job having tying the mechanics to the theme And like I said, I love a bag builder where it's a coin purse and you're pulling out coins and lining them up on the jukebox. That's just fantastic.
And Mo wasn't quite clear there. It's the 40s, 50s, and 60s are the three decades involved there.
Well, when I say three decades, 40s to 60s, I figure people could figure out which one's in the middle.
You fubbed it. I don't know why you have an aversion to the 50s, but apparently the music of the 50s does not exist. I don't know. What I want to talk about with this one is the first time we played it, because the first time we played it was like, it might have been half a year ago, maybe a little bit longer, 8 months ago. And we were talking about biases and playing games, right? So we sat down and played it at a, I don't know, it's kind of a brewery, but it's not really a place conducive to playing games. And we were kind of pushing it, playing a game there. Not that we ticked them off. We were the only people there that night, but it wasn't a great setting. It wasn't a great table. The lighting wasn't great. And Mo already had a bit to drink and he broke at this new game we'd never played before. And we botched the rules. So we had like the most subpar possible experience of it. But I walked out of there hating that game. I thought it was one of the stupidest games we had tried this year and was really disappointed that we had agreed to review it. I was like, why did you say yes to this? And then we tried it again this past weekend. And I was like, wow, this game's actually really good. You know what? When you play it by the right rules, it's amazing. The game's actually a decent game.
Playing a game by the right rules makes it better. Who knew?
Yeah, exactly. But it was like in every possible way, that first play was just, I was like, why do we have these stupid jukebox frames? They don't fit nicely on the table. They seem excessive. It felt fiddly, the way you had to draw all the components, the layout, the setup process, everything about it. Then we did it this time. I went, this all makes sense. It fits on this tiny table at the coffee shop. I don't know what the heck my problem was with it that night. Apparently, I didn't want to be playing it.
I think one thing that game could benefit from, though, is upgrading the coins to a like the plastic upgrade tokens from Quacks. They do stick a little bit in the bag. The felt versus cardboard problem gets. I know at one point I dumped the bag to make sure I had all my pieces. To put the game away, and half the pieces didn't fall out. It was, you know.
I mean, I don't think they would do that because of the publishing cost. And then I can't see it. I don't want to. I can't see it as a game worth upgrading.
Yeah,
fair.
I was gonna say what I'd like the most is metal coins. Like, come on, then you get the jingle. Like, that'd be awesome. But no offense to the publisher, but that's not a game I'm gonna buy metal coins for. It's a two-player only quick half-hour game. It's just that, to me, upgrades are for bigger, longer, epic games that are going to hit the table and that I want to show off to my friends.
So you got anything else for us, Mark?
The only other game we got in yesterday was about a half dozen rounds of The Crew. And I would ask you, what can I say about The Crew that hasn't been said before? I had previously not been well-versed in The Crew. I will say that the way my brain thinks is not necessarily very indicative of the success that we're trying to achieve. And I was definitely frustrating some of the other players at the table by what essentially were illogical moves. So it was a lot of fun, but for everyone, I think it was very, very stressful because I was a bit of a wild card in not a good way.
Do you feel like it eventually clicked in and that next time you play it better, or are you always going to be that force of chaos?
Maybe. It really is just, you know, when you're trying to achieve a certain objective, there are things you are supposed to do. And I just couldn't wrap my head around it. Like, I would play a trump card completely arbitrarily, thinking I had a reason, but not realizing I actually undermined what we were trying to do. And then I would do it again. Like, because I thought, okay, this time it makes sense to do it. But no, it didn't. So.
We had some interesting experiences when we were playing. We actually have, as a group, I think we've only ever played it on Board Game Arena. We've played it with some patrons in the past. And it was one of those things where, you know, Modi and I play games together all the time, but we added in a patron who's not, you know, part of the game group, you know, great person, but not in that same mindset as the other three of us. And again, that game requires a sort of unified mind, you know, play style thinking, thinking along the lines. And so we did have chat open, and we were talking within the limits of the game, rather than just playing blindly on Board Game Arena. But we had some of those problems too, simply because we weren't that unified game group that it kind of wants. True.
That game with a stranger really highlighted, I don't think we realized how much in the groove we were, having just known each other and played together, until we brought in a stranger into the group and then went, this is no longer working.
Right. Mm-hmm. Well, we've been playing trick-taking games together for like 30 years, right? So we have our own tells and things, and knowing when to follow and what we normally do. And the chat room agrees, right? We got a Major Kayla saying that I don't like the crew, but my friend's other game group adores it. Doesn't enjoy big group trick taking. And then Time Roller states trick taking tactics elude me. Gaming buddy has been raised by his parents on trick taking games, sees them easy pass so easily. And that's what it's like for us. Like, we grew up playing trick taking games. Like, there's never not been trick taking as part of my life. My mom right now is at a euchre club. Like, she's not in the other room right now. Like, that just, it's always been part of our lives.
Yeah, that was the extent of my Tuesday gaming, and I'm looking forward to doing it all again next week.
All right, well, we're going to talk about one of Mark's games, sort of, with Endeavor Deep Sea, because this one, we've been talking about our plays over the last few weeks. We've been exploring the game further, and honestly, by the time you listen to this, if you're listening to this live, I just tune into our last episode to hear the full review. For those of you in the chat room, you get to hear that later in the show. But I still want to talk about it here, because last week, we tried the game cooperatively for the first time. And we also got to see two of the mini expansions. And while one of the publishers is here right now, so I thought it'd be interesting to talk about while he's here. Starting with co-op, I liked it. Mechanically, it worked very well. I loved how impossible it felt to accomplish the required goals up until the end of the game. I've always surprised in every game of Endeavor Deep Sea how much people get done in the last two turns of the game. How much the impact board fills up, how much the board grows, how many more tokens get put out. And I've got to say, it was even more so with the solo game. By the end of round five, we had two goals accomplished. That's it, which means we would lose. By the end of the game, we had five done. We managed to get three goals done in those last two games, and they were not easy to do. And it required us to sit down and kind of plan out everyone's whole turn together before anyone did a single thing, just to be able to get those goals. Like, we had a person who was in level two in green, and we needed them to be at the end of the board by the end of the round. And we found a way to get them to like six or seven increases in green before the end of the game.
Yeah. And we're actually talking about co-op, not solo. That was a misspeak on most part. Sorry. It didn't feel like quarterbacking, though. It really felt like we were working together to try and solve the problem. I will say it was our youngest daughter's first time playing the game. And I think every game of Endeavor has had this feeling to me where it starts off kind of slow. There's not much you can do. And it feels like you're never going to achieve those goals. And there's this part in the middle where you feel like you're getting nowhere. And then at the end, it ramps up and all of a sudden you achieve massive things. When we got to that middle part in that co-op game where it looked like we were going to lose, like we were definitely going to lose this co-op game, she kind of checked out. She wasn't as interested anymore. And I think part of that was because it was her first play and she didn't see, like, it was just like, this isn't possible. Why are we even still playing this? And like me, she doesn't love co-ops to begin with. So she's like, I'd rather be playing this competitively and we're going to lose. And then we sat down and we went, okay, but, you know, we should probably just ignore this goal totally. We're not going to get it. Wait, we might actually get it. Let's try and do this and this and this. And then all of a sudden we ended up getting like six out of seven of the goals instead of failing the game. And it was all that huge ramp up where, which just seems to happen in Endeavor every time, where all of a sudden we went from nothing to we're doing all the things in the last round, which doing all the things cooperatively together, that did feel very, you know, like we accomplished something.
And I will say by the end, she liked it, right? Yes. Once we got our whatever, I forget the level we ranked out, expert or whatever it is. It was like, oh no, I like this game, though I think I'd still rather play it competitively. And amusingly, what she made us do is when we finished the game, we had to calculate our scores to see, even though we would have made different decisions, obviously, there were things we did to help other players out we definitely wouldn't have done in a competitive game, but she still wanted to figure out our scores. So that, I thought that was pretty funny.
Yeah, I was really interested in this one. I've only gotten to play Endeavor Deep Sea once, two player. My gaming time has been limited lately, but I was really interested by playing through it once in the first scenario and getting a good feel for it and interested in it, and then looking through the other scenarios and looking at just how much more game there was to play, even ignoring the fact that there are expansions and promo cards and things like that. I was really kind of like, okay, I really want to find time to play this again, mm-hmm. to experience the challenges in those different scenarios. It was wonderful.
Yeah, Sean, along the same lines, I was super disappointed when most of you were going to review this week, because that means it'll get set aside and we probably won't play it again in the next couple of weeks because we're done with it, right? And I was like, are you sure? You sure we don't need at least one more co-op play, something, another five-player game before we can properly review it? I think we might need another play or two. But yeah, I got outvoted.
I'm glad you spent time with it.
Now, I do have a question for you, Mark, since you're here. Yeah. And I don't know if you can answer this because you're the publisher, but with the co-op play rules as written, they have you choose your goal before you start playing, right? You're supposed to declare, we're going for four goals, or we're going for five, or we're going for all seven. And I was wondering why that was, because I looked at that and I didn't see any reason to declare it ahead of time. What we did is we just played and then looked back and used that as our score. Like, how good did we do? That way we could kind of try for everything. I'm just wondering if there was a reason to have players pick, like maybe that removes that feeling of this is impossible if you knew you're only going for four.
I cannot answer that question. Okay. I was not in the development for that part of things, so I'm not even going to conjecture. I'll simply say that I did have, you know, we still chat about it in our own Endeavor, Facebook group. And I just told Jarrett and Carl that I felt that they had outdone themselves with Endeavor Deep Sea. There. So I'm, impressed with it every time I play.
Now I just want to mention the mini expansions. We got the deluxe edition because people were really curious about these. So we talked about the Orca reintroduction tile the other day. So we're going to skip mm-hmm. over that other than say, put it in right away. Like first game, there's no reason not to Agreed. Toss that one in
you can
right
just away. Pop them all in, I think.
And from what I understand, that one also comes in the non-deluxe version. I'm not positive on that.
I didn't think so, but.
Okay. I thought that was the one that was unlocked as a bonus for everyone. Now I only have the deluxe, so I can only talk to the deluxe.
Well, but it might have been a bonus for everyone who was participating in the Kickstarter or the crowdfunding is what I'm trying to say.
Okay, yeah. Fair enough. Now, Robotic Wanderer is neat, very powerful, lets you move to a spot and take actions on a different tile where the little wanderer is. And those actions can be upgraded by publishing papers. Proved to be very powerful in a cooperative game. And there's one specific sonar-only depth 5 card or tile that actually I feel is a little broken using that, because there's a way to do it where it doesn't cost you a sonar token to take the action. So you can just get there and take the action every turn by just pulling sonar tokens out of the pool, not your own supply.
Yeah, it's a very specific little combo, though.
But that's a combo. Like, that's not going to come up most games, probably. And again, co-op was more where it came into play. That one, I wouldn't want it to come up every game. Like, I don't mind it, but it's a cool addition. I probably wouldn't toss that in my first play. Once you know the game, though, I would.
You know, the one thing I will say that was very satisfying about co-op is the way when you you place tiles for research or for conserving, and if you place them with two that are connected, you get a bonus. And we ended up doing some very strategic things to maximize the bonus that we would all get, to make sure it wasn't just one person getting the bonus, but as many people as possible getting every possible bonus mm-hmm. thing off of it. So that was neat. I'm like, that felt cooperative, and it didn't, I mean, you're not changing the game board. It's the same game board that I would play competitively. I would just have a different outlook on it. So I thought that was cool.
Yeah, we definitely had the like, okay, now it's your turn to head over to the reef and play here so we all get a thing.
Yeah, I really like how the linked spaces in Deep Sea, a virtuous circle. Everyone benefits, whereas the linked spaces in Age of Sail were a zero-sum game. If you were on the outer edges, no one got it. So, mm-hmm. And I think that speaks to the story we're trying to tell, that science and research is collaborative. And to use a particularly apropos turn of phrase, a rising tide lifts all boats.
Underwave Academy, that's the last mini expansion. We did have that come up the next game, our last game, and I really like this one. This is a spot you can go to upgrade one of your level one or two team members, giving them more action options. Starts off that it's like you can do this or, and then eventually it becomes you can do this and I really like that. And then there's a whole thing where you can go in and upgrade them as well by publishing the papers and stuff like that. So I got to say, I like that one. Again, I think you want to get used to drafting the specialists you want for your strategy before modifying them. So again, I wouldn't toss this in your first game, but once you play it a couple times, it's going to be in every game we play.
Ton of fun. I love that tile.
All right, well, the next game that got played by folks is from Kedrick Winks. Now, this is the designer we've talked about a few times, especially since our last trip to Origins, the designer of Psychobabble, The Crooked Crown, and Shadow Ninjas, which we've all reviewed in the past. But his Halloween-themed game is Cadaver.
So this is a great thematic game for this time of year, great game to be playing in October, Halloween-themed game. I mainly opened this up and got it played so that we can bring it out to our Halloween themed game night tomorrow night at the Walkerville Brewery. In this game, you're playing necromancers who are raising the dead through the use of scrolls, potions, and of course, brains. It's a card game where you get a hand of cards. You're going to play two cards around, then replace those from cards from the deck. Cards include corpses, which each need a set of three ingredients, coffins, which can lock up an opponent's cards, keys used to unlock coffins played on you, ghouls, which can steal cards from your opponents, and amulets, which can be used to scare off the ghouls or as wild cards. Then there's also assistants that can join your team, and they let you now draft ingredients from a central supply. So you're not drafting from the random deck. You're getting the specific ingredients you need. Now, at the end of the game, you're just getting points based on who you've resurrected as a necromancer. 10 points per set of three matching corpses, 5 for set of three different corpses, 1 point for everyone left over. There is like a Frankenstein's monster that takes one of each resource. He's worth 5 points if you can get him into play. Quick playing, easy to teach, 100% language independent, no art on here whatsoever. And I don't know what I'd call appropriately creepy for Halloween. Like, it's corpses and undead and there's brains and it's kind of gross, but it's kind of comic booky, cartoony. It's not realistic looking. For people who've heard us talk about our daughter Genevieve all the time, she loved this game and had no problem with the artwork.
Yeah, it's not that there's no artwork. It's that there's no words. I'm just here to correct Mo tonight. So yeah, Jen loved this game, and she's been in an anti-game kind of phase. So she agreed to sit down and play it kind of like, fine, I'll play a game because I want to spend some time with you two people. And then by the end of it, she was like, can we play again? And maybe a third time. And she quite liked it. And I also have to say, I was not super excited about sitting down to play this one. Like, I was just like, it's not, you know, and it was fun. It was a little bit more strategy there than I thought we had going in. You do some interesting things with the way you lock up other people's corpses and stealing and blocking stealing and all of that. Like, there was just a little bit more, like, it's not a lot more, but just a little bit more there going on than I thought there was going to be, that there is some strategy to the game. And yeah.
The only complaint I have about the game is also a benefit. So one of the things they did to make the game thematic, and I kind of dig this, and I should have took it off. I should have it here so I could show you. But the game box is designed so that the insert looks like a burial mound and the cards go in the insert, and you're supposed to leave them in there while you're playing. So you're digging through the grave to pull cards, which is awesome and cool and thematic, just like a little silly thing. Like, don't put the deck on the table, keep it in the box until you get down to the last two cards that get stuck every single dang time. And you end up having to bang the bottom of the box to get them out. So
it wasn't even coming out when you were banging the bottom of the box. Like, those things were really stuck.
So that could have been used to be just a little bit bigger, a little bit more tolerance. Now, Sean, you got a quick look at this one, basically, I'd say a demo of the game. Do you have any thoughts on Cadaver so far?
This one played really well. It was really easy to pick up. I mean, it was interesting because when you were first teaching it, I got a little confused because there's a couple of little cards and it's like you got the goblin and this and that. But as soon as we actually started playing, it all just sort of, this is obvious what this happens. It's almost better that you don't explain it and you just sort of, that's this, and get going. And it's that really good, you know, beer and pretzels casual level of game that really fits into the category of games that I adore.
Here, so last play, Picture Perfect from Arcane Wonders. I don't know if you played this, but this is a brilliant game. We did a demo of it at Origins, ended up picking up a copy when we were on vacation. So it was a game we bought ourselves. You have a small scene, a table with a backdrop and 18 standees to place into the scene. You get an envelope for each guest there. So there's 18 envelopes and each one gets 3 preference cards. You only get to see a small subset of those, say 3 of them. You look at them and then rearrange your picture. Then there's a round where you're swapping around who has what package. And then you look at your new packages and rearrange everyone. You keep doing that for 6 rounds. Then you take out your cell phone, take a picture of what you've done where you can't see anything but game components with the picture. Then you reveal all of the envelopes and you get points. Based on if you got one of the requests right, you get 1 point. If you have 2 of the requests right, you get 3 points. If you have all of the requests right, you get 6 points. If you have none right, if the person's like next to the wrong person, not near the table and in the back, you lose 3 points. There's also a little system with VIP cards you can do to double people. It's a super clever game. Huge hit with my extended family. We brought this over to Brenda's on Sunday. Genevieve loved it. Brenda loved it. Deanna and I had already played it before, and it was as good as I remember.
It's neat in that your scoring is judged by, you need a cell phone. You have to take the picture and your scoring is judged not by what I can see looking down from here, but on what you managed to snap in that photo. So, I mean, I thought that was going to be really gimmicky and stupid, but it's actually pretty clever.
Now, the reason I asked you to stick around is I have a complaint and maybe Mark can shed a bit of light on this. As a publisher who runs demos at cons. So I mentioned that we played this game at Origins first and foremost. So we sat down at Origins and there was a demo person there that taught us the game, extremely competent at teaching the game, good with getting along with people. And we sat and we played. And while we were playing, one of the things that's happening is there's these objects that are on the table. And we're like, I asked, I said, well, what are these objects for? And the demo person said, well, they're just decorations. You put them wherever, they don't mean anything. Well, then I get the game to the table finally last week and I learned that there's an advanced mode, like a gamer's mode, where half of the passes in the envelope phase where you're passing them to other people become auctions and you use those objects as currency to bid for the auctions to try to get to see the people you haven't seen, which I thought was really cool. And honestly, that is something that would have sold me on the game even more than the demo we played. Perhaps convinced me to pick up the game at Origins instead of only grabbing it when I found it deeply discounted up in Northern Canada. And going, why not? Because this will be popular at public play events. If I had known those objects were a currency and there was auction phases, I would have been way more sold. And I'm questioning the fact, why didn't the demo person point this out? Now, I don't know if it's the fault of the demo person or the company's training or the direction the demo person was given. Like, I specifically asked, what are these for? And was told, no, these don't mean anything. They're just for looks.
They said they're to make the pictures look better when you take them. That's what they said, yes.
I'm gonna default to improper training. Doesn't okay. I mean that is just a very strange set of circumstances, in my opinion.
So my question was, like, would you dumb down a game for a demo just to make it shorter for the demo? Like, if you're training your demo team, do you teach them the full game? Because we had something similar happen with Star Realms, where we sat down to play the newest Star Realms Frontiers box set. Is it Frontiers? Now I'm forgetting the name. The newest Star Realms box set includes cooperative play. And we were just sitting and playing with it ourselves. And when a demo person came over and said, oh, we want to try the cooperative rules. I'm like, well, I don't think that plays co-op. And I'm like, well, I have the rule book right here and it says it plays co-op. So I was just wondering, like, is there a direction where publishers would be telling them, well, you don't want to overwhelm people for, so skip this part.
Certainly, I think the most important thing about doing a demo is getting people playing quickly.
Right.
That, however, does not mean that you shouldn't equip your people to answer questions that aren't part of that. Like, I'll give you an example. Very often when I demo Endeavor, whether it's Age of Sail or Deep Sea, I will give a very brief explanation and I will say, just start doing things. You cannot mess up this game in the first 2 rounds. It is impossible. So just do the thing and learn mechanics. And then you'll understand how to make tactical and strategic moves later on.
Well, that's it for what we've been playing. Join us again in 2 weeks to hear about what has hit the Bellhop's tabletop.
And now a message from our sponsor, Grand Gamers Guild.
Of course. I mean, obviously, I want to talk about the Holiday Hijinks Collector's Box Kickstarter that's going on right now. It is doing extremely well. You can continue to use your support over the next couple of weeks. You know, beyond that, just subscribe to my newsletter, jump on the Facebook page, although I'm not a fan of social media. It really just kills me that people say they want to hear from us, and then the social media algorithm decides whether or not they actually can. So jumping on the newsletter is probably the most important thing you could do because that's our direct line to you.
Is there a quick link for the newsletter that we can share? Is there like a GrandGamersGuild.newsletter? Is there a quick link?
If you go to GrandGamersGuild.com, it's right at the top of the webpage.
It's right at the top, yeah.
And you can just plug it in and confirm, and boom, you're off and running. You know, beyond that, you know, when you're talking to Grand Gamers Guild, you're almost unconditionally talking to me. If you send me an email, if you send me a Facebook message, it's almost always me. So I appreciate that. Just reach out if you have a question after this show.
All right, I got to call this one out just to show that this works. Charlie Brown Windsor, I am backer 752 for Holiday Hijinks. Woo-hoo! Your appearance here tonight. So
thanks, man. I really appreciate that. Thank you.
Yeah, I'm just going to say that there will be links to everything we've been talking about in the show notes.
Awesome.
All right. Do you have anything else you want to add there,
Mark? Oh, yeah. You know what? Actually, let me do an additional plug for Inferno. Inferno is on its way. It is in the line of like a How and Pillars of Heracles. It is a heavy Euro. It is visually stunning. It is just absolutely fantastic in its implementation. It is evocative of its theme. And I'm so excited that I was lucky enough to be asked to localize it. The cord has arrived. That's why I'm leaning into my screen and trying to plug it in here.
We saw Inferno laid out at Origins, just the board and the setup and everything. Like, you had a demo copy laid out, and it does. It looks super evocative of the theme with the Dante's Inferno thing. And I'm excited about that one.
Yeah, I just cannot wait for that to get in the world. It's October 23rd. I'm not sure folks will have it for Halloween, which kind of kills me for them. I wish we had pulled that off, but logistics, man, you know, stuff's got to get overseas. We were delayed the tiniest bit by like a day by the port strike, you know, then it had to get to PSI and, you know, then they had to intake it. And when they were taking it in, I was just getting back from Essen and just dealing with all the Endeavor Deep Sea post-fulfillment cleanup, which I'm still eyeballs deep in. I am used to having my inbox at 20 emails. I am over 200 and fighting to get it towards 200 on a daily basis ever since I came back from Essen.
It's time to put another dime in the jukebox, baby, with our review of Vinyl Jukebox, a rather thematic two-player-only board game.
Vinyl Jukebox was designed by Eric Alvarado and comes from Talon Strike Studios LLC, who we have to thank for providing us with a review copy. This is a standalone spin-off of the board game Vinyl, and except for the fact you're collecting records, the two games share little in common.
Which is not actually something we knew until we opened the box. This is a two-player only thematic board game that can be played in about half an hour. The game features some pretty cool components, like two jukebox-shaped player boards, tokens designed to look like coins, and of course, a selection of two-sided LP tokens. You can see all of this in our Vinyl Jukebox unboxing video on YouTube.
The goal of Vinyl is to fill your jukebox with the best music collection ever by collecting 9 records, which will score you points for completing sets, fulfilling personal collection goals.
In Vinyl, each 45 has 3 traits. 1 of 5 music types, blues, country, rock, jazz, and pop, a decade, 40s, 50s, or 60s, and if it's the A side or B side. You'll claim records by having a set of coins that matches all 3 of the traits for a record that's in the market at the center of the table.
This is a bag builder, and each player starts off with identical bags that include 1 coin for each music genre, 1 for each decade, and 2 each for an A side and a B side. You also get 3 bonus scoring cards, and then you pick 2 of those to keep. During the game, players will get to pick up additional bonus coins. The bonus coins are sort of split coins where each coin represents 2 things, a music style and a decade, and then they can be used as either type. You may also end up earning rival coins, which show a single aspect. They're much like your standard coins.
Now, on a player's turn, they will either insert coins or cash out. When cashing out, they collect all coins in their coin slot and put them into their bag, and also get to collect 2 bonus coins. Your opponent then gets to take 1 coin from their coin slot and return it to their bag.
Now, the standard action in this game, the one you'll be taking the most often, is insert coins, which you will pull 1 token out of your bag, 1 at a time, and place them onto your jukebox. There's two rows you can place them in. Each holds up to four coins, and you have to place them left to right, but you get to decide which row to put them in each time. If you happen to draw a coin that matches an aspect of something you already have in play, you can put that coin on top of an existing coin. Now, a single coin can also be placed into your next play slot. This coin is returned at the end of your turn, so it just goes back in your bag. Now, on the board, there are some spots with diamonds on them. If you cover one of those, your opponent gets to pull a coin as if they just took the insert coin action.
You have a lot of choices here, because it's up to you if you continue to pull coins, and it's up to you if you want to stack them too high or not. Yep. You can continue to pull coins until both rows of your board and your next play slot is full, or you can choose to stop at any time. You then have two options. You can either claim a 45 by moving the required tokens over to your coin box and then returning any bonus coins spent to the supply, or you can exhaust a full row, moving the coins in it to your coin return and claiming one bonus coin for each row that you exhaust.
Claimed 45s are placed into your jukebox. When completing a row or column of three, you also get to take one scoring token, usually the one with the most points, with sets of three being worth more than sets of two, which are more than singles. If you are the first person to claim a specific type of tile, your opponent gets a rival coin matching that type, which they add to their bag.
Now the game ends once a player adds the ninth 45 to their jukebox. You finish out that round, and then if the other player has any incomplete rows or columns, they didn't get to nine, they get to collect scoring tokens for the ones that are incomplete. If there are none that they can claim, these incomplete rows or columns are worth 1 point each.
Players add up the points on their scoring tokens, as well as points earned for one of their two personal gold cards. You pick which one you want to score on. The gold cards score points for having specific genres of records in specific places on your jukebox, and for collecting records from a specific decade and a specific side, like A side or B side, with bonus points if you have 45s that match both. And the player with the most points wins.
Nice and easy, ages 10 plus, half an hour at most, two-player only game.
Now, the real draw of the game is that theme and the way the mechanics are tied to the theme. Like, your board is an actual physical jukebox that's in front of you, and you literally fill it with round 45 discs. They're laying flat. And it's done neat, so it's like a dual layer board, but it's actually just there's a cutout. So you're using the table as the second layer. You're going to line up coins on your jukebox, and then you're going to use those coins to buy records and eventually cash yourself out to get more coins, to buy more records. Everyone's got different music tastes represented by the scoring cards, and you're each going to be trying to collect different things, but there's only one copy of each combination in the game. So competition can be fierce.
Yeah, it's a two-player game, but it manages to feel tight in a way that I usually only find in games with larger player counts. Like, everything you want is right there. It should be easy to get it, but it's not always. The other thing I wanted to mention is the way you get those little scoring tile tokens, and they fit onto your jukebox in a way that looks like the placard on the front of a jukebox. Something about that I find really satisfying.
Although I have to say, when it comes to theming, it's a little weird to be dealing with A-sides and B-sides because I've never seen a jukebox that could only play one side of an album before. So that's a little off.
Now, the fun in this game comes from the decisions you have to make and the push your luck aspect of it, right? It's a bag builder. Do you keep drawing, hoping to get exactly what you need? But then if you draw more, too many tiles, half of your coin slots, and let your opponent get a free coin, right? So do you keep going and letting your opponent get a bunch of free draws? Knowing what's in your bag is important. There's a bit of a memory aspect here, so you need to know your odds. And if you play right, you can have it, so you know the next thing you pull from your bag, you're going to be able to buy something. Or the next three, it doesn't matter what my opponent does. When I draw these three, I'm buying this and I'm good. Maybe it's worth grabbing LPs that aren't perfect, right? If you're trying to collect 80s from the 40s, you might grab a 60s B-side because it could get you a good scoring token because it's your third, say, blues album in a row, even though it doesn't match your goal. Or you could just be like, I'm not buying anything right now. I'm just going to build up my bag for later. And all I'm trying to do is fill my rows as quick as possible so I can empty them to get those bonus tokens so I can make a big move later in the game. Maybe the coin you drew is better later, so you put it in that next round slot. Like, there's a lot of decision points in this game for what sounds really simple and basic for a quick game.
Yeah, once you figure out the coin distribution, it's more like a logic puzzle. Yes, there are luck aspects to it, and it is a bag builder, and your bag can get cluttered up if you're not careful about what you put into it. But With the way you can leave coins sitting in your coin return or in your next play slot, you can manipulate the odds. And I mean like all the way up to 100% to ensure you get exactly what you need to buy the next tile. On the other hand, once you realize that there are only 2A and 2B tokens and you can see all of them sitting in your coin return, you know it's time to refresh your bag and pick up some bonus tokens along the way.
Now, of course, some people will be bothered by the fact that there is a lot of randomness in that bag pull, and there's not really any way to plan ahead for your turn because you don't know what's going to come out of your bag and you don't know what 45s are going to be available necessarily when it gets to be your turn.
See, I argue you really can tweak your bag so you know what's coming out of it by not emptying your coin return and having, you know, when the other person empties their coin return, you get to put one coin back in your bag and you've got your next play slot and you're putting one coin back in your bag. And if you do that just right, you'll know exactly what three coins are in your bag or what two coins are in your bag. And you can kind of tweak it that way. That's neat. And then, of course, once you eventually do have to dump your slot, because you are going to run out, then you end up with this big bag full of who knows what. But there are turns there where you can really strategically figure out what you're going to be pulling. It's neat.
Yeah, I got to say, I don't actually agree with that either. I think this is one of the games where you have the more control than usual over your bag, what's in it, at what time, what you're going to pull. And yes, the right records may not come up, but that's part of the game. Like, you are going to have to figure out, look at the scoring tokens and see what's worth two and what's worth three. And because it's going to be almost impossible to fulfill every goal on your goal card. And you should realize that and pay attention to, yes, my opponent drafted that card, but that's fine because I'm now going to get three countries in a row, which is worth 10 points. I got to say, like, for a game that is this random, I don't find it too high at all. Now, I do have to say, when we first tried this game on a date night, it did not go over very well. The rulebook could be improved. The biggest fault I found is actually a layout issue and not a clarity issue. There's a very important key piece of information that to me is kind of hidden off in the side. It's next to an example of play, and it looks like the test is just explaining the example. Meanwhile, it's a key core rule. The first time we played, we totally missed it until the end of the game. And then when we returned to the game, I missed it again and got confused. And it was the fact at the end, remember last time after we finished playing, we figured this out? And she had to point it out. She's like, it's on this page. It's right here. And I'm like, that's what we screwed up last time.
Okay, so I'm going to say, I don't tend to read rule books. Mo reads rule books. Mo teaches the games. I play the games. Because I don't read rule books as often, I do not have an expectation for how a rule book should be laid out. I grabbed the rule book and I went, I'm looking for this information. There it is. That more or less made sense. Mo went, no, that's in the sidebar. It looked like an example. I would not look for a key piece of information there. And I'm going to bow to his expertise in how, you know, the majority of rule books are laid out. But I will say, I found it,
So one thing I have seen, I have not seen the rule book on this, and I was trying to find a copy, but there isn't a copy on Board Game Geek for me to look through. But there are a number of reviewers, commenters on Board Game Geek who rate the actual rule book as the absolute worst part of the game, calling it terrible.
Yeah, I agree. Now, the rule we missed is when to stop drawing coins, like kind of a key thing, right? So we played our super extreme version and kept drawing until we could buy. We were exchanging full rows and grabbing bonus tokens and emptying our coin purse and drawing more tokens until we got the ability to buy something. And honestly, that ruined the game. It was terrible. It was bad enough that it took us months to return to it. Sorry about that, Talon Strike Studios. But it was a bad experience. The thing is, though, when we sat down last week at an awesome new coffee shop in Amherstburg and played with the proper rules, we found a very solid and engaging two-player game. And hey, playing the game by the proper rules makes it better. Who knew?
We liked it so much. We played it a whole bunch back-to-back over the last, like, 10 days or so. Yeah, that first play was so rough that I had no urge to return to this game. When you pulled it out, I honestly, if we did not owe someone a review, I would have said, I don't want to play that. I've done that and it was a terrible experience. And then we sat down and played it properly and it was actually remarkably solid two-player game. Yeah. Very strategic, very enjoyable.
Now, one issue that did remain that was a problem our first play that could keep this game on our shelf and not get it played is how much room it takes up. And I think it's just an expectation of ours for two-player games. You expect two-player half-hour games to be small and be able to be played at a coffee shop, on a small bar table, possibly even up at a bar. And I love the fact that it looks like a jukebox and that jukebox player board looks like a jukebox and the scoring tokens go where you'd read the album names. And I love it. And I like how the 45s are larger than the other discs. And they don't feel like a 45, but they feel significant. And I really dig that. And the game, but the game ends up taking up a surprising amount of space because in addition to your jukebox, you also have to have a market of 9 45s out. But in addition to that, you have to have all the bonus tokens in display. And you probably want to sort them in an order that makes sense, like by decade. And then you got all the scoring tokens. There's two scoring tokens for every single aspect. And on top of those, you're putting a bonus coin. And it just takes up more room than I'd like. Like, my favorite two-player games aren't just solid games. They're very portable and they work at a variety of tables, including small coffee shop and pub tables. And Vinyl Jukebox just takes up too much room for many of our usual hunts. Maybe this is totally a us thing, but it stops it from being a game that I'm just going to keep in my van. It's not, and it's a bigger box. It's not a small little card game box, right? It's a bigger box to fit all these components. And Deanna can't fit this in her purse, right? So it's not huge. It's no table hog, but it's just bigger than I'd like it to be.
Yeah, it's definitely not a purse game. And it fits in that nice 20 to 30 minute window where I would take it to coffee shops and breweries, but you need a medium-sized table. Like, it's going to fit on any kitchen table in the country, but not most of those wheeler around coffee shop tables.
And because of the way the components lay out and the reason it takes up bigger space, the box is a little bigger than it needs to be. And they have sized the rule book for the box, which may in fact be part of the problem with the rule book.
Overall, I got to say, I'm glad we gave it another shot, right? This is another game that proves you should never give a game on the first play, on one play. No game. The Bellhop's first law is the first game time you play any game, you're going to play extreme. And while we played this more extreme than usual, you got to give games more than one shot. One shot's just enough. Like, for another more extreme example of this, check out our review of Scythe from Stonemaier Games, because that was another game where our initial experiences were not good and we returned to it and had a great time. So sitting down to play this game a second time, we had a totally different, much more enjoyable experience that led to more plays and more good times. Leading to me to be very happy this is in my collection. Actually, this is a great two-player only game. It's a great addition to our personal collection, which is awesome. Deanna and I are always looking for two-player games to play together, especially ones that play quick and still have a lot of depth and decision points. This is not a quick-playing party game, two-player game. There's some thinking, there's some decision points here, and this game fits perfectly for that. I just wish it took up a little less room, because then it would be in our two-player games we bring with us everywhere list.
I agree with you on all of those points. So I have nothing to add there other than to say that it's an enjoyable two-player experience.
For me, I think this would probably be a pass for me. I think the bag builder aspect and the focus, especially on the focus on the scoring cards, puts it a little bit more intense than sitting around a coffee shop enjoying and chatting. You're focused more on the game than you are on the environment and chatting. And so that takes it a little bit away from the sort of game I would be looking for at the coffee shop.
Sure. Yeah, I think vinyl would be a great game for music fans, right? If you know someone who collects vinyl, come on. The mechanics here are easy enough that people with any hobby game experience should be able to pick it up. The game's dripping with theme. I don't know about Gateway. If you're not a hobby gamer, that there's a few things going in with the bag building. And well, the fact, maybe you'll have a better chance on the rule book than I will, because you don't have an expectation of where to find certain things. So I don't know about like total Gateway game, but like any hobby, if you play Catan, you're going to be able to play this.
To enjoy the game, I think you need a, like, there's a little more going on here. It's towards the heavier end of light. And I will say, I went into us playing this a second time thinking I was going to hate it. And I was shocked by not just enjoying it, but like loving it and going, man, I can't wait to play this again.
Now, I also think that fans of quick playing under a half hour, once you learn it, two-player games with lots of decision points will dig this. its set collection, order fulfilling, and bag building with a solid tied-in theme.
Now, what I can't do for you tonight, and I kind of wish I could, is compare this to Vinyl, the original game from Talon Strike Studios. The full-on record-collecting game where you're going to stores and shopping and trying to get your vinyl collection to grow. So here where I'm going to call on our fans, right? If you played Vinyl, how does it compare to Vinyl Jukebox? Especially love to hear from anyone who's played both.
And with that, I'm out of coins and the music has come to a stop. Music-themed games seem to be hot the last couple of years. Yeah. So we want to know which ones you think are worth checking out. What is your favorite music-themed game? Let us know in the comments on social media or over on our Discord.
You know what the worst part of spending all your coins on the jukebox is? No change left for coffee.
That's terrible. But you can help us out. If you enjoyed this review and or the other content we put out, you can show your support by topping us up at tabletopbellhop.com/coffee.
Well, that was the double bell.
Means our shift's coming to an end and we're going to have to lock the lobby doors.
Before we start locking things down, let's take a moment to thank a selection of our Tabletop Bellhop Patreon patrons.
Gutshot Games, thank you.
Diane Tuzano, thanks, Ma.
Thank you, Dukas.
Roger Milosh, thank you.
Kat and Tori, thank you.
Jeff and Sheila Seuss, thank you.
Your first stop to finding us should be at tabletopbellhop.com, but you can find us all over the web as Tabletop Bellhop, one word, and on your podcatcher of choice as the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast.
If you have any questions that you'd like us to answer in our Ask the Bellhop segment, please reach out either by email or just messaging us on Instagram.
Thank you so much for joining us today. And if you like what you heard, I would love it if you post a review on iTunes. And while you're there, subscribe to get notified of upcoming episodes.
Something else you can do that I think helps us more than all of that, actually, is to tell your gamer friends about our show. Spread the word. Point them to the articles and reviews on the blog. Share a link to our YouTube channel. Tell them where to subscribe to our newsletter, etc. Word of mouth can be a powerful thing. That's all for tonight.
For the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast, I'm Sean.
I'm Deanna.
And I'm Mo.
Thank you.
And game on.